Today I'm going to talk about love, very sweet subject. So to get into a mood of love, I want to play, I just want to listen all together, pop music, the secular music. Whenever I think of love, this song comes to my mind. So I hope you enjoy that, and is that be okay? It's a secular music. It's a song by the legendary British rock group Beatles. All You Need Is Love. Take a look. Okay, it took me to the times when I was a teenager, and I love that song. It changed the world brighter to me. I've met a mother of a girl who had multiple disabilities, blindness, and developmental disorder. She had never been out of diapers until she died at the age of 20. Her mother said that she and her husband had experienced really hard and rough times taking care of her while she was alive. And I'll never be able to forget what she told me on her daughter's anniversary. She said, while we were taking care of her, it was extremely hard. She took lots of sweat and tears from us. But for the last 10 years, it has been harder to live without her. It takes more tears from me than before. If somebody asks, what is this all about? Our answer is all about love. All you need in life is love. On every Easter Sunday afternoon, I drove around the town to deliver Easter flowers to the homebound and the sick, and share the joy of resurrection, because I felt that I need to honor the old-time members who had dedicated themselves to building and growing this church, but who are now unable to travel to the church because of their health or age. When I visited a man at the Pinnacle Senior Apartment, I noticed a flower on the table. And when I asked him about it, what he told me made my heart so warm, he said. I bought it myself to remember my wife who passed several years ago. I found the beauty of humanity in this 91-year-old man. When a human being loves another from the deepest part of their heart or soul, it is so beautiful that nothing can be compared with that noble humanity. What is that all about? It's all about love. All you need is love. When we hear a story about a soldier laying down their life for their friends, or when an elderly woman that has dementia is cared for by her husband day after day, year after year, when there's a 10-year-old African-American boy filled with fear, but he offers to give out free hugs at a protest march. Have you seen this story? Take a look at the next screen. There's a picture about this. And a big cop comes along and wraps his arms around that kid. When a cold heart melts in a marriage headed for disaster, that's reborn. When somebody lies dying in a hospital bed, and they are surrounded by friends and family that have shared life with them. In those, all those moments, we know it's all about love. And all we need is love. Life is all about love. Love is real. Love is what matters most. Love is the measure of our humanity. Love is the purpose of our lives. Our highest calling in life is to love. Life is all about love, and all you need is love. It's already getting to the last week of January, but at the beginning of the new year, people often make resolution, I want to be a better person. For Americans, the number one category for resolution is getting in better physical shape. I want to be healthier or more attractive. The second most popular resolution is financial well-being. I want to make more money and get my financial life in shape. And a lot of people have goals around career success, or people have educational goals. They want to get smarter. All of those are good things. There's nothing bad about them. But what's this can't-miss resolution? One day, the Apostle Paul was writing to the church at Corinth, and all of a sudden, in the chapter 13, he says these amazing words. Take a look at the next screen. Paul says, "Though I speak in the tongues of men and angels, if I have not love, I'm nothing but a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains from here to there, but if not love, I'm nothing. I give all I possess to the poor and give my body to be burned in the flames, but if not love, I gain nothing." In other words, Paul saying, though I know the whole Bible and all the great knowledge of the world, but have not love, I'm nothing. Though I'm the wealthiest and the biggest giver, but if not love, I'm nothing. Though I have the highest IQ, though I'm the most socially smooth and have all kinds of human networks, but if not love, you are nothing. You might put the equation like this. According to Paul, everything minus love, nothing. If I do not have this love, my life amounts to this is nothing. On the other hand, if I have nothing, but I add to it love, I have everything. Now, Paul gets this idea about the importance of love from Jesus, who said one time, look at the next slide, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself." All you need is love. And Jesus also said, take a look at the next screen, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I loved you." Did I love you? Then, as I loved you, that you also love one another. By this, when you love, by this, all will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. Love is our highest calling, and love is a demonstration that we are true followers of Jesus. That means if you hate, all people will know that you are not my followers. These are sobering words. So personally, I only have one resolution this year. I want to be a more loving person. Just one resolution. I want to be a more loving person by the end of this year than I am today. And that's my hope for our church, for each of you. Now, if your goal is to be more physically fit, you will probably join a gym. If you want more financial health, you might use an investment firm. If you want more career success, you might get a mentor or take a class. Then, if you want to grow in your capacity to love, where should you go? Well, you are there. This place right here, the church. The whole purpose of church is to increase the amount of love in our world. Let me ask a question. Is this church full of love? Then, why is loving others and people around you so important? Well, it's easy. Like the Beatles says in the song, it's easy because all you need is love. Feeling loved is a primary emotional need for all human beings. All you need is love. When your love tank is full, you are emotionally satisfied. Child psychologists affirm that every child has certain basic emotional needs that must be met if he or she is to be emotionally stable. That emotional need is for love and affection and the need to sense that they belong and are wanted and loved. With an adequate supply of affection and love, the child will likely develop into a responsible adult. But without that love, they will be emotionally and socially challenged as they grow up. There's a metaphor that I like. It says, inside every child is an emotional tank. Take a look at the next screen. There's an emotional tank waiting to be filled with love. When a child really feels loved, he will develop normally. But when the love tank is empty, the child will misbehave. Much of the misbehavior of children is motivated by the cravings for an empty love tank. I totally agree with this. You know, there's a fuel tank not just in a vehicle. We human beings have a love tank in our inner being, in our soul. Until the love tank is filled, we'll never be happy. Somebody said, what good is the house, the cars, the place at the beach, or any of the rest of it if your husband doesn't love you? Do you understand what she was really saying? More than anything else, I want to be loved by my husband. Or want to be loved by my wife. I want to be loved by my father. I want to be loved by my mother. Something in our nature cries out to be loved by another. Isolation is devastating to the human psyche. At the heart of humankind's existence is the desire to be intimate and to be loved by another. And so marriage is designed to meet that need for intimacy and love. That is why in the book of Genesis, the Bible spoke of the husband and wife becoming one flesh. And it meant that the married couple would enter into each other's lives in a deep and intimate way of relationship. Do you remember what Adam said when God made a woman? Take a look at the next screen. He said, he was very surprised because the Eve was so beautiful, and he said, "This is bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh. We become one flesh." Now you and I are in the most intimate relationship in the world. It's marriage. And there's an invisible emotional love tank inside couples and all love people. If its gauge is empty, the love would be gone, relationship would be dead, they would never feel close, though they are still physically together. What if we could know and practice a way to fill the tank? Keeping the emotional love tank full is as important to a marriage as maintaining the proper oil level is to your vehicle. Running your relationship with your spouse, your children, your parents, your friends, or any of your loved ones on an empty love tank may cost you even more than trying to drive your car without oil. Probably, I know this most in this room because very recently my car broke down by running out of oil, and I had to get it to be junked. Right. Then how? How do we love others? In his book called The Five Love Languages, take a look at the next screen, Gary Chapman helps people identify five ways. What is the particular way God has made me give love and receive love and learn about the other people in our lives? So we'll be able to love people more effectively. And his conclusion came from more than 20 years in the professional counseling ministry. And the core idea of the five love languages is that we all have certain ways we most speak love and receive love from other people. For some people, they get love most when it's expressed through words. They love to speak and hear words of love and affirmation. For some, it's spending quality time. When you hang out with me, then I feel your love. For some folks, it's in the giving of gifts. Some people are really creative and very thoughtful around gift giving. I know some. Some people value acts of service, and servanthood is how you express love and the way you are able to give and receive love the best. And for some, it's physical touch, just that experience of hands or a warm hug. The basic idea is this: genuine love seeks to be helpful according to the other person's needs, not according to my preference. Often people misunderstand one another and feel unloved by their spouses, their parents, and friends because there's a breakdown of communication at the level love is expressed. And so understanding the five love languages and learning to speak the primary love languages of your loved ones may radically affect your relationship and their behavior, because people behave differently when their emotional love tanks are full. On Christmas morning, my kids are at their best because their love tank is full, right? Now think about a few key people in your life. Maybe your spouse, maybe your parents, maybe your kids, or maybe a friend, maybe somebody at work, maybe somebody in this room now. You can just think about it. Which of the five love languages is the best way to communicate love to this person? How do I go about doing this? I think when it comes to my children, Harrison and Haley, their love language is physical touch. They love when I hold them, when I hug them. For Hayden, it's a quality time or gift giving. And for Hendrickson, four of them, right? I have time to memorize that. Hendrickson, he always comes to me and like this, raise his hands and love me, love me. I believe his love language at this point, physical touch. Most of our infants and most of kids, our younger babies love physical touch. And for my wife, I have no idea. But I guess quality time and actual service. By the way, learning to speak the love language of the people in your heart is crucial. Now, we are briefly looking at how to express love through word of affirmation, the first love language. This is from the book of Proverbs. It says it's a fabulous word. Take a look. Next screen. A word aptly spoken is like apples of gold in settings of silver. The right word at the right time, in the right tone, to the right person is like gold. Beautiful. You can remember getting a word like that from somebody in the past. This week, pick somebody in your life, a friend, a child, or a spouse, and give them one compliment a day, each day this week. We can all do this, and it has to be honest and sincere. It has to be non-manipulative. You know what I mean? Non-manipulative. In our world, so often, instead of being sincere, love-sounding words are just used to manipulate people. I was at a restaurant with a friend a while ago. I ordered a soup, and our server said, when I ordered this soup, brilliant. Then my friend ordered salad. Then the server said, perfect. When it was time to order a main course, I ordered something, and the server said, excellent choice. My friend ordered something different. Wonderful selection. It just kept going that way. Beverage, fantastic. Dessert, you will love it. I finally asked the server, have you ever told somebody what's a stupid thing to order? And it's interesting. The server told me that in the kitchen, they had a list of 9 affirmations. And they are required as a condition of their employment, every time anybody orders anything, no matter what it is, to respond with one of those 9 affirmation statements. It's brilliant, isn't it? Even though that's not sincere love, that's just inflating people's egos to get more money out of them. It shows that saying words of affirmation make people feel better and happy. Apples of gold in settings of silver. You could do that. If a server could do it to a stranger at a restaurant, you could do it to your loved ones at home, in school, at work, or by phone call. This week, pick somebody, one compliment per day, all week long. Because words has power. The power of words can move you tears, bring absolute joy. There are words of encouragement, words of sympathy, words of love and admiration. The right words can give you strength and hope. Words will inspire you, bring you back to life. They will comfort you in your need of time of need. Words will nourish your soul. You do it to your husband, your wife, your child, your neighbors. Remember, one time I was looking specifically at all the words Jesus spoke in the Gospel of Mark. Of course, he's the master of speaking words of love. But what struck me was that the first words involving love in the Gospel of Mark were not words spoken by Jesus. They were words spoken to Jesus. After he had been baptized by John the Baptist in the Jordan River, Mark says, a voice came from heaven. Take a look at the next screen. That God says, you are my beloved son. With you, I am so pleased. See, Jesus needed the words of affirmation. I think Jesus was rooted in that love and that voice from the Father in heaven. And I believe that words of affirmation led him to be able to complete his mission on earth up to the cross of Calvary. In just a couple of moments, this service will be done, and then it will be time to participate loving, to practice loving. You know, when we come to church, it's great to learn, but it's not just all about learning or worshiping. We come to love. We come to be loved. That's why we gather together with other people. I remember a woman named Mary Craig. One of the Saturday people, she passed in fall 2013. I remember her, that she always listened to my message very carefully. And when the service was over, she always came to me and encouraged me with warm and positive words. Thank you for your message, Pastor. It was so nice. Thank you. It was good. I needed it. Thank you. It was so nice. But later on, I heard that her hearing was so poor that she could hardly understand my message. But her comments were still the same. Thank you, Pastor. It was so good. I need it. Can you imagine how much her words of affirmation meant to me as I began a ministry as a brand new pastor and continued to do my ministry with boldness and courage and encouragement? Don't get me wrong. Now, I'm not saying you should do it to me all the time, but you should do it to each other, and you should do it to your loved ones. Then I'm sure it will give them new life. This week, each day, you just take a few moments for the expression of love to people around you. Practice saying words of love, words of affirmation that will change their lives and your life too eventually. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, thank you that you reminded us today of the most important thing in our lives, that is love. Life is all about love. All we need in life is love. When we leave this world, when our heart beating stops, when our breathing is done, when we come to you in heaven, we know what you would ask, how much you love others. Lord, this year, no, for the rest of our lives, we want to be more loving person day by day, year by year, all the time. We want to try to be a more loving person, embrace others, give them words of affirmation, give them gifts of time, gifts of our resource. Lord, we want to love our friends, our husband, our wife, our children, our co-workers at work, more wisely, more effectively. Lord, teach us. And more than anything else, we want to love you more. Lord, please have us in this loving, most intimate loving relationship with you all the time. Thank you, Lord. We love you. In Christ's name we prayed. Amen.